back. Did everybody survive the snow apocalypse? Everyone made it? Everyone had a lot of fun, loved every minute of it, right? Right? You guys know how much I love snow. So last week it was glorious. 2.5 feet of snow. The Panthers won. Panthers won the Super Bowl. It was a really good weekend for me. Also, I feel a bit of pride because basically every church in the city canceled their services. Not us, right? That's one of the advantages of living next door. We still had about 40 people show up on the historic snowstorm Sunday, so I was pretty excited about that. We had a fun, kind of intimate time there. We obviously had to postpone the business meeting, so if you're here, you're in luck. Business meeting today, please stay. Members, we need you. We got lunch provided for you. We'll get started around 1 or 1:15, so big, important business meeting. But I knew we were going to have so few people last week that I saved 1 John for you, because I didn't want you to miss it. I knew you'd be sad if you missed part of 1 John. So we worked on something else last week. But now we're back and ready to get back into it. And I'm thankful for the passage that we're about to look at, because we've been looking at this book for about 2 months now. And if you're new here, this may be a little bit strange, but this is what we do. We take a book of the Bible, we read the whole thing, and we walk through the whole thing. My job is to simply explain to you what the scriptures say. So we read it, I explain it to the best of my ability by God's grace, and the next week we move on to the next passage. We want God's word to be central to what we do here. We want God's word to inform everything and to speak. And to do that, we need to read that word and to explain that word. So we've been walking slowly through this book, and it's a book that we've been arguing is about how you can know that you know. Remember, 1 John gives us this series of these three tests that we can use to help us know whether or not we are believers. There's the theological test. Do you believe the right things about Jesus? There's the relational test. Do you love the people of Jesus? And then there's the moral test. Do you obey the commandments of Jesus? And John is saying throughout this letter that if you can answer in the affirmative all three of these questions, then you have good cause to believe that you really do know God. Remember, John writing this letter, and he's an old man at this point. He's probably in his early to mid-80s. He's written this letter 1925 years ago, or somewhere around the year 90. He's an old man. He's been living a long life. He's been a minister for most of his life. And he's understanding and realizing that there's nothing more important than knowing God. And he wants you to know, at the end of his life, that you can know God. And that you can know that you know God. And that knowing him is the most important and fulfilling thing in the world. He wants you to know. Thus, these tests that we've been looking at. And we'll continue to look at them, especially next week. But this week is slightly different. He's been telling us how we can know. Now we want to look briefly at him telling us why we can know, which is important. He's been saying you can know if you believe rightly, if you love rightly, and if you live rightly. But there's a risk, I think, as I've been working through this. There's a risk of all this sounding very kind of formulaic or mechanistic. There's a risk of us hearing, well, just do these three things. Believe the things about Jesus, try to love people, and then, you know, try to obey, and then you can be saved. No, that's not at all what we're saying, right? That's what the world tells you. That's what every other religion tells you. The world tells you it's acceptance by achievement, right? Be good enough, be beautiful enough, be valuable enough, and we will accept you. So you better strive and work and succeed and gain. It's exhausting. But we're so used to hearing it that we don't even really notice. But John is telling us something different entirely. The gospel is something different entirely. These tests that he's been giving us are not the means of our salvation, but they are the evidence of our salvation. Today, we're going to start off by looking at the means of our salvation. Not how we can know, but how God actually saves us. And then we're going to look at the benefits of that salvation. I don't want you to understand just what salvation is. I want you to see why it's good. I want you to see why you should desire it and long for it and love it. So simple cause and effect here this morning. The cause and effect of salvation. The cause is going to be being born of him. The effect, there's going to be three effects we'll look at. We're going to see confidence, conformity, and children. I'm going to read the text for you, and then I'll walk through and explain to you what all that means. So look down at your copies of the scripture. 1 John chapter 2, verse 28. We're going to go to a kind of an odd stopping spot. Chapter 3, verse 3. And we might actually save verse 3 for next week, but I'll go ahead and read it. We'll see what we're doing time-wise. But let me read it for you, starting there in verse 28. This is the reading of God's Word. And now, little children, abide in him, so that when he appears, we may have confidence, and not shrink from him in shame that is coming. If you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of him. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Bow with me and let me begin our time with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the privilege that it is to come and sit under the preaching of your word. Father, thank you for the privilege that it is to stand here and to preach that word. Father, it's a responsibility that I take very seriously. It is a responsibility that I know that I am ill-equipped for, that I am not up to the task for in and of myself. So, Father, for my sake and the sake of everyone in here, we ask for your Spirit to come in and to work through your word. Make it clear to us. I pray that I will be clear and that your gospel will be clear and the effects and the benefits and the blessings of that gospel will be so clear that you will put it in our hearts to greatly desire and pursue those effects. Father, help us to understand. And in understanding, help us to know you and love you more. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so I'm going to start off by focusing first briefly at that little phrase there at the end of verse 29 that would be just easy to pass over because this is foundational to everything else. Isaiah, if we miss this part, this whole letter can feel like a checklist of things that we need to be and do, and if we are and do those things, then we can be Christians. No, don't go there yet. First, it starts here, verse 29 at the end there. Christians are those who have been born of God. Now notice what it doesn't say. It doesn't say, if you practice righteousness, you can be born of him. It says that if you have been born of him, you will practice righteousness. And that order is important. It's not that we do good first so that we can then be saved. That would be salvation according to our works. It is that God saves us, and then we do good in response. And that order changes everything. And John, as he does, is simply restating something that Jesus himself taught John decades earlier. Flip quickly over, if you want, to John chapter 3, the Gospel. It's page 887, if you want to get there quickly in the pew Bible. It's at the bottom of the page. This is the story when Nicodemus, who's a religious leader, who's got some sort of interest or attraction to Jesus, but he knows that he's kind of not someone to be caught with at that time for a Pharisee. So he goes in the cover of night to try and talk to Jesus and try to understand a little bit about what's going on. And there in John chapter 3, Jesus says to Nicodemus in verse 3, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." All right, so here's the same language of birth that John is using in 1 John. And if you're on page 888 now, or if you're looking in your own ESV, look down and you'll see footnote number 1 there at the bottom, which gives a possible alternate translation of the verse. It could be translated not necessarily born again, but born from above. Right? The word in the Greek there could basically mean either of those things, and it probably means both. In verses 5 and 6 and 8, Jesus describes this birth as being born of the Spirit. So before anything that we're about to talk about is possible, and we're going to talk about a lot of good and wonderful blessings and benefits, but before any of that can be yours, then this must first be true of you. This is the cause. Everything else we're going to look at is simply the effect. You must be born again. You must be born from above. You must be born from the Spirit or of Him. And I want to emphasize this for a moment, because some of you are new and unfamiliar with this, but also because some of you have been here for years listening to me, and you're still unfamiliar with this, right? We've been so indoctrinated to think of acceptance and identity and salvation according to achievement, according to accomplishment, and how well we perform, that we have this inborn tendency to transfer that over into our understanding of the gospel. So I want to be very clear that the gospel is nothing like that. And I think that the birth terminology is really helpful in that. Because in the general understanding of the salvation across the spectrum of religions in the world, including even some Christians' understanding of this, we play a vital role in the process of our salvation. Right? That just sounds like it's correct, right? Because that just makes so much sense. We play a key role. In Islam, everything depends on you keeping the five pillars of Islam. How well you're doing those determines how well your scales are going to weigh out and whether or not you can be saved or not. Buddhism involves you following the Noble Eightfold Path, and how well you do that determines your future and where you end up. Judaism, it's about keeping the law. And even in many branches of Christianity, it's about figuring things out and believing and choosing Jesus of your own power. But the similarity in all of these things is that the onus is on you and what you do. But think about the language that John is using when he talks about birth, or that Jesus uses to compare salvation when he talks about birth. How much was your physical birth dependent upon you and what you do? Zero, right? In the birth process, you were entirely passive. Others worked really hard, and you benefited, right? You didn't choose your parents. You didn't choose to be born. You didn't choose when to be born. You were just born. You were given this gift of life. That's birth. And that's the metaphor that Jesus chooses to use to describe spiritual salvation, new birth. Thus, like physical birth, spiritual birth is not something that we work for or that we earn or we choose or we do. It's something that God has to do for us. It is a gift of His grace. It is unmerited and unearned. God graciously works on behalf of those who are His, and He regenerates them. He brings them from death to life. He does it, not us. Right? Listen, that's why we've talked about this a couple times today. That's why we don't do altar calls. Because altar calls imply in some way that our stepping forward and our making this walk or our doing this, that, or the other plays some key role in the new birth. No, right? We don't play a new role in the new birth. Listen to the words of John Piper here so you can not be mad at me, be mad at him. He says, so if you ask, well, what can I do then to make the new birth happen? Well, the answer is that you can't do anything to make the new birth happen any more than an unborn baby can do anything to get born. We can't believe the new birth into happening. We can't love the new birth into happening because the new birth has to happen first so that we can believe and so that we can love. Right, so there's this key order, right? God's grace comes first. God's work comes first. It's not our work or our faith first so that we can be born again. No, God has to work in our hearts on our behalf first. What are we called to do? We are called to simply believe. We are called to trust. That's all faith is. Faith is trust. And when we have done that, we can know that we have been born of Him because you cannot believe without His work in your heart first. So your charge and your command is to believe. It is to have faith in Jesus. It is to trust in the work that He has done in your place, but knowing He's the one that does it. Right? That's what grace is, an unmerited, unearned, unsought-after gift. You must be born of Him. That's the cause. That's how we become Christians. All these tests, right? There's this risk that we hear these tests. Okay, I do these things, I'll be saved. No. All these tests that we're looking at are simply ways that we can see and confirm that that new birth has actually happened to us. Right? The cause is God's work of new birth in our hearts. He does it. But now I want to spend the rest of our time looking at the good and the glorious effects of that new birth. Here are the results. We see number one in verse 28. It says that we may have confidence and not shrink from Him in shame at His coming. So number one is confidence. And this is a pretty bold statement because it's almost certain that we think of Christ's return too lightly. We've gotten pretty used to meek and mild, long-haired Jesus hugging children and lambs. Saw some little statues where Jesus playing soccer with some kids or something. Like, oh, that's cute. Sure. But we've forgotten entirely sometimes that He is also God. He is a warrior. He is the judge. He is the king. And when He returns to bring justice and to set wrongs right and to defeat His enemies. We generally ignore the Revelation 19 description of Jesus. Have you ever really read and pondered the Revelation 19 description of Jesus? Here's what John, same writer of our book, describes Jesus as at the end of the Bible. He says, then I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, the one sitting on it is called Faithful and True, and in righteousness He judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on His head are many diadems. He is clothed in a robe dipped in blood, and the name by which he is called is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God, the Almighty. Man, that's pretty intense. Christ's second coming is nothing like his first coming. Christ's second coming is about justice. Christ's second coming, he comes in power, and he comes in glory. And the imagery that we are given here that we generally ignore is fierce imagery. But that description of Jesus, that coming of Jesus, is the coming of which John says, back in our chapter, that we can have confidence of and not shame. I don't know about you, but reading that description of Jesus in Revelation 19 and how he returns wants me to be able to have that confidence. Right? I don't want to be on the other side or on the wrong team when that happens. It's either confidence or shame. Now, there's a disagreement over exactly what John means here. Is he talking specifically about salvation? Right? Confidence, you're saved. Shame, you are not. After all, remember, Jesus has some very chilling words for us in Mark chapter 8, 38, when he says, "For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels." Man, have you ever really dwelt on those words, right? Have you ever felt ashamed of Jesus at work or at school? Have you been afraid to speak up or afraid to stand out, afraid that people would find out and think less of you and ridicule you for your beliefs? Listen, we've all been there. I'm not saying that if you've ever done that, that you're not a Christian, because, listen, you have done that at some point in time. But we should be concerned, though, if this is what characterizes us, if it is our tendency to kind of keep our heads down and try to hope that no one kind of finds us out or asks us a hard question or asks us what we think about this or that or the other. Are we ashamed? Do we talk about Jesus? Do people even know that we claim to be Christians? Does shame mean salvation and not saved? Or it could be possible that John, since he's writing this letter to the church, to Christians, that he doesn't imply shame to mean no salvation. Right? Like in 1 Corinthians 3, Paul talks about the day of judgment, and Paul writes that there will be some whose work is burned up and who will suffer loss, though they themselves will be saved as only through fire. Right? So there's some sense where, listen, we're all sinners. No one, Christ isn't going to come back, and none of us are going to be perfect, obviously, because that sin remains. So maybe all he means here is that there is some shame could mean we're not doing what we should be doing, or there's some sin in our life, or whatever it is that John specifically is talking about. Shame is not what we want to be experiencing when Christ returns. So he tells us to abide. That's what we talked about last week. It means to remain in Christ, to cling to him, to rest in him, to depend on him. When he returns, we want him, by God's grace, to find us doing the things that he loves and not the things that he hates. Have you ever really, at some point in your life, been just busted, right? Like as a kid, maybe just caught completely red-handed. Right? In our old house growing up, we had a separate living room in the front of our house with this awful green floral furniture. We had all this wallpaper, and it was this hideous room. But that's where Mom sent you to stay and to wait until Dad got home if he did something bad. It was not good news to be called to the living room or to be sent to the living room. We all knew what that meant. And the shame or the fear of the hour sitting there knowing that Dad's coming back, and the first thing he's going to hear is what I did, and the first thing he's going to do is to come talk to me about what I did. Right? That was that pit gut feeling of shame and fear. When I was a freshman in high school, we just really liked fireworks. I was a kid. I liked fireworks. I liked fire. And you couldn't buy good fireworks in North Carolina. It was illegal. So we felt kind of cool, like we were smugglers. We'd slip down below the border to South Carolina. Because in South Carolina, they could sell good stuff. They could sell bottle rockets little N90s and the mortars that showed you the really big ones. So we'd go down to South Carolina and we'd buy real fireworks and we'd come back up and bring them to North Carolina. And we had this big stash that we carried around in this little yellow Umbro bag that we called our bag of fun. And my parents knew we had them. My My parents trusted us. They trusted us to not do anything too stupid with them, so they knew. But one night, it was 3 in the morning. Again, my parents didn't trust, they trusted us. We didn't have a curfew. We had a curfew after this story. So we went out, a buddy of mine, we were in the neighborhood. Jeff, who lives up here now, actually. Jeff had a crush on another buddy of mine, Erich's sister. Erich spelled his name E-R-I-C-H, so we called him Erich. We thought that was funny. So we thought it would be a good idea if Jeff wanted to see Erich's sister, then we'd shoot some bottle rockets out our window at 3 in the morning. Seemed like a fine idea. Didn't work, she didn't wake up, I don't know what happened. But unbeknownst to us, someone called the cops and reported gunshots in the neighborhood. We had no idea that happened, so we failed to get this girl's attention, so we just took our bag, we're 14, we're dumb, we're just going to walk back home in the neighborhood, and we see headlights in the distance, we don't think anything of it, and the headlights get a little bit closer, and then the headlights throw on the bright lights, and then the headlights throw on the police lights, and it skids to a stop in front of us, and the cops jump out, hands on their guns, and say, "Get on the ground now." Terror. Pure terror. Cop with a gun, me on the ground, my face on the ground. Cop pulls me up, cop puts me on the car. I'm 14, I'm terrified. Cop frisking and checking and figuring, because they're thinking gunshots. There have been gunshots. There's been a report of a gun. They go through us, they go through the bag, they realize they're just fireworks. There's no guns, there's nothing really thing like that that's happened. So they have mercy on us, and all they do is call our parents. But I was at the bottom of a hill, my house was at the top of the hill, and you could see it. And the 5 minutes that it took my parents to walk down that hill, with my hands on that car, just knowing that my parents were coming, knowing that the cops are the ones calling and bringing my parents, the fear and just the shame and the embarrassment that I felt, that I had caused that to my parents. Dad, the pastor of the community in the area, here is his son on the police car. Now Dad's walking down his road at 3 in the morning. Terror. That's the shame, right? That's the fear. I don't want my dad to be having to come to me in those situations. I don't want to be caught in those situations and my dad being disappointed and finding out what I was doing. The misery and the shame that I felt for days after that were just terrible. That's not what we want to experience when our Heavenly Father returns. And that's why John says, abide in Him, rest in Him, remain in Him. And if you do that by His grace, you can have confidence. And the word in the Greek means more than just confidence. It means boldness. It means brashness. That when He returns, if we are in Christ, if we're abiding in Christ, then we have nothing to fear when the great warrior king returns. Robe dripping in blood, sword, all this imagery. We have confidence and nothing to fear. When everyone else is trembling and afraid, we are hoping and we are overjoyed that Christ has returned. That's the confidence that we can have if we are in Christ and we are abiding in Him. Do you have that confidence? Do you ever actually really think about the return of Christ? Because for much of my life, it was like, okay, I know this is supposed to be good, but could you just hold off? I'd like to get married. I'd like to have some kids. I'd like to write a book or this. I'd like the Panthers to win a Super Bowl. Give me one more week. Just kind of putting off. And then I'm not sure. Do you really ever think about it? Is that something that you look forward to and long for and desire? Or is it something that if you really think about it, it kind of unsettles you a little bit? What's this going to be about? And where is my standing? And how am I going to do here? No, in Christ, though, John tells us that if we are abiding in Him, we can actually have confidence when Christ returns. But that's not all that we can have. Look at the beginning of verse 29. If you know that He is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of Him. And we're not going to linger here long because we're going to talk about this a lot in more detail next week. But I think what John is saying here is pretty simple. This is basically the moral test, which is coming back to next week, presented in a different way. Remember the moral test, we can know that we are Christians if we obey His commandments. That's what righteousness is. It's not that complicated of a concept. Just drop most of the letters off of it and you have right. Righteousness means right. It's morally right or good behavior. It's behavior that accords with a standard, and in this case, God's standard. But we've talked a number of times about how biblical righteousness also carries it with the idea of kind of this relational component. To be righteous biblically is to be right with. It is to be right with God. And we've already said we do not become right with God by our righteousness, but that God declares us to be right with Him based solely on the substitutionary work of Christ in our place. And then once declared righteous, we begin to more and more be made righteous and do righteous things. But the righteousness that we do is in response to God's grace, not before God's grace. Guys, salvation here, what we're seeing is salvation is more than just rescue. We've done a great disservice the past little while in church history just talking about salvation as it's kind of this get out of jail free cards. Oh, it's this escape to heaven. That's what salvation is. And well, listen, salvation is eternal life. It is eternity with Christ. But it's more than that. It's not just rescue. It is an entire renovation. It is transformation. Since He is righteous, He makes us righteous. And all John is saying here is that God's people will be like Him. And not to ruin the ending, but the highlight of this passage is the important truth that God makes us His children. We'll get to that more in a moment, but children look like their parents, right? Children image them. They reflect them. They are like them. If you were to look at some baby pictures of Melissa and I, you would see some striking similarities between us and our girls. There's so much of each of us in each of them that we can never quite decide which one looks like which. We always laugh because one of you will come to us and be like, oh, Lila looks so much like her mother. And then someone else comes like 2 days later, oh, Lila looks so much like her. And then each person comes and tells us that each kid looks like one or the other. But we can't tell because there's so much of each of us in them. Children look like their parents. And not only do they look like their parents, but for good and for bad, they also act like their parents. Now that is terrifying. That's a terrifying thing to me as a parent. I've started to recognize how much Emma talks to traffic and how much Emma talks to football and basketball game on TV. I've mentioned before that as a parent, I realized I had to kind of clean up my language a little bit. Right? It's not like I was running around swearing, but around my little children, I didn't want to say things like stupid and darn it. It's fairly minor things that we don't think about, but things that I don't want my kids picking up on. So as I told you before, I adopted, and what comes out of most of my mouth when I'm driving and watching basketball is, come on, what are you doing, right? That seems so, that's safe, right? You can't go wrong with that. There's nothing bad there. Well, it's become my daughter's choice phrase as well. Emma has watched me for 3 years struggle to not get frustrated and often fail in traffic. She's watched me for 3 years get frustrated watching the Tar Heels. It's been a rough 3 years, and she's picked up my bad habits. Come on, Meeks, is what she says. That's my favorite thing. That's our center. She gets mad and frustrated at Meeks. Right? She does what I do. I read a lot, and I want to intentionally do that while my girls are around because I want them to grow up with a love of books and an appreciation for their importance. That will only happen if they see me loving and appreciating books. I want them to love and appreciate good music, so I listen to music with them, right? I read the Bible with them at night because I want them to have an appreciation for the Bible. Every Saturday I talk about how excited I am to go to church on Sunday because they pick up that excitement and they're like, oh, church tomorrow, great, this is fun because Dad likes it, so we like it, right? Children are like their parents. That's all John's saying. And God's children are like Him. That's simply the moral text. Our growing righteousness is a reflection of who He is. And that is great news for a struggling sinner like me. John Newton, author of Amazing Grace, go get his letters and read them. They're brilliant. He once said in one of those letters that I'm not what I ought to be. I am not what I want to be. Yet I can truly say that I am not what I once was. I love that quote. Right? I can get pretty caught up looking at my present circumstances and looking at the sin in my life. And I can despair over that sin. But when by God's grace, I can look back over the course of the many years that God has been dealing with me and working with me and that God has been faithful to me, I can see clear evidence of His hand of mercy. By God's grace, I am not what I once was. That doesn't mean that I am what I want to be, but I'm not what I once was. And by His grace, I'm slowly becoming more and more like Him. Slowly, I'm becoming, being made to be more and more like my Heavenly Father. When we are born of Him, we will be like Him. And guys, that might sound boring, or that might sound... No, the point is that there is no one better to be like. He is perfect, and He is good, and He is kind, and He is merciful, and He always does what is right. That's the one that we're being made into the image of. But that's not all conformity means. It's not just about moral conformity, about our character growing and being more like Him. That's great, but it gets even better there in verse 2. We know that when He appears, we shall be like Him. This is, I think it's one of the most ignored great truths of Scripture. I think we shy away from this because, quite honestly, we don't know exactly what it means. We tread, I think, on holy ground here. There's no cute illustration to make this clear. But in some way, when Christ appears, we will be like Him. When Christ appears, it's the end. He doesn't come once and then 7 years and He comes again and then 1,000 years and a year. No, like when He comes back, it's the end. And we're told here that when He comes back, we will be like Him. I'm just trying to wrap your mind around that because I can't quite do it. We will be us, we stay us, but we will be better. We will not be less physical, but we will be what physical was actually meant to be before we screwed it all up with the fall. We will be ourselves, but we will be purified. We will be restored. We will be better. We will be perfect. We will be glorious even because He is glorious and we will be like Him. This is not some weird salvation or eternal life. Heaven is not some weird kind of angelic beings. You know, like the Looney Tunes cartoons, like Bugs Bunny dies and he's up on a cloud. He's kind of see-through and he's got a robe on. He's playing with a harp. That sounds awful. Like, I don't know, the harp? When you just sit there and what do you do? And no, that's not what we're talking about here. No, Jesus comes down here. He fixes this. He fixes us. He restores His people. He restores His creation. And then we get to spend eternity enjoying Him and enjoying all of this as it was meant to be. If you are born of Him, you are becoming more like Him. And when Jesus returns in some glorious way that we can only begin to understand, you will be as He is. Guys, whatever it is that plagues you and ails you now. I just did this, right? My shoulder does not work right now. I just did this and it really hurt. So I'm kind of wincing there for a second, right? Whatever dumb little ailments or aches or pains, well, what if you're experiencing actual real suffering or pain or disability or cancer or whatever it is? All of those things, whatever limitation, whatever suffering, whatever loss, whatever hardship, all that will be gone and utterly wiped. It will be restored. It will all be made new. Everything will be perfect and good and fixed and restored. That's our hope. That's a great hope, right? That we don't just go up there and like He comes here, He fixes us, and He fixes this, and we get to spend all of eternity enjoying Him in that creation. That's conformity. We will be like Him. We will be as He is, and we will relate to Him as we were meant to relate to Him from the very beginning. Right? We have confidence, we have conformity. Last thing, real quick, how can we have such things? It's only because of the last point, which we've already alluded to. Verse 1, see what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called the children of God. And so we are. I really like the King James actually better there in that verse. There was a song where the King James says, behold, I love that word, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. Have you heard that song? Behold the manner of love the Father has given unto us. I've thought about singing it, but nobody knows it anymore. It has this more weight, but it's behold. Behold what manner of love that we should be called His children. Verse 2 says, beloved, we are God's children now. And listen, this won't hit you as it should unless you first understand that not everyone, by nature of their birth, is a child of God. For most people, this revelation that we can be called God's children isn't that big of a deal. Oh yeah, of course, we're all children of God. No. To really appreciate the weight of this, you have to first realize that apart from Christ, you are, or you were, not God's child. You are his enemy. We so flippantly throw around the idea that God loves everyone, that there's nothing really special about this truth. Now listen, yes, in some sense God does love everyone. But we've got to understand that love can mean different things and there can be different degrees of love. Our church has been exploding with children lately. David's wife Betty had a baby last week and she's here today, which is amazing. Right? So there's a wonderful thing here. That's awesome. Jenny is having a baby here soon. I don't know if everyone knows that yet, but Jenny's having a baby and it's kind of blew up her thing. Melissa's having a baby here in a couple of months. And Jen is next to mine in 2 weeks? A week?
11 days,
Dave's wife, Jen, is having twins. So in the course of 3 months, that's 5 new babies that God is bringing into this church. That's wonderful. That's really good. Listen, I love kids. We're about to have a third one. I'm already pushing for four. It's still on the table. We're still working at it. But I love kids. Kids are precious. Kids are important. They are fun. I love them. I love all the kids here at Woodside Community Church, but I do not love all of them in the same way. Because there are two of those kids, and there's about to be a third of those kids that I love differently than the rest of those kids. I love the kids in the nursery. I love Thea. My love for Thea is different than my love for Emma and Lila. Right? Emma and Lila are my children, and Thea is not. So my love for them is unique. And the fact that they are my children means that I love them differently than the other kids, and that means that I act differently toward them. I take them home with me. It would be weird if I took other kids home with me. No, I provide them. I protect them. I feed them. I teach them. I discipline them. I give up everything that I have. I sacrifice everything that is mine for my children. That is exactly what God does for his children. Yes, there is some general sense in which God loves everyone, but he has a unique and special and saving and abiding love for his children. And I want to tell you that this love is the best thing in the world. The brilliant 19th century novelist Victor Hugo, he's the guy that wrote Les Mis. I tackled that book 2 years ago and it was wonderful. You should read it. And the play is obviously great. Go see the play or the movie. But in the book, Hugo writes, he says, life's greatest happiness is to be convinced that you are loved. I think that's really good. And I think he's mostly right. It's what we're all looking for. We just want to be accepted. We just want to be loved. That's why we obsess over our looks. That's why we go to such great lengths to hide our true selves from others. Right? We put on all these fronts and we put on a show and we act like we have it all together. We take selfies and we meticulously obsess over the lighting and how we portray ourselves on Facebook and Instagram. It's because we all want to be loved. But Hugo is only partly right, because being loved is almost life's greatest happiness. We put on all these fronts, we go to these great lengths, though, because deep down we fear that if people really knew us, that if people really knew who we were and what we were really like, in a way, they could actually love us. So we've got to hide and put on these things and put on the best. We're afraid that if they know us, there's no way they'll love us. So that implies to me that there's something more, that there was something more that we want than just to be loved. And Keller, actually, I think one of the most brilliant things he's ever said, puts it actually better than Hugo in his wonderful book, The Meaning of Marriage. Everyone should read that book if you're single or married. It's the best book written on marriage in the last 20 years. Get it and read it. Here's what Keller writes in this book. He says, to be loved but not known is comforting, but it's superficial. It's not really, no one actually really knows what's fake. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. Like someone finds out and then, oh, they really got to know me, and they know me. They don't love me, they don't like me, I see. So to be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear, but to be fully known and truly loved is, well, a lot like being loved by God. This is what we need more than anything. This liberates us from pretense. It humbles us out of our self-righteousness, and it fortifies us for any difficulty that life can throw at us. To be known and to be loved. And that's exactly what we have as children of God. Because here's the bad news and the good news. God knows us better than we know ourselves. He knows every single thing that you try to hide from everyone else. He sees all the warts. He sees all the flaws. He sees all the terrible things that you've done, that you're ashamed of, and that you hope no one else finds out about. God knows about all of that. Yet he still loves his children. He still pursues and adopts his children. He still accepts us and rescues us. That's the type of love that you need most in the world. To be known and loved. And only God can really do that. But the even better news is that he doesn't just accept us as we are and leave us as we are. He accepts us as we are because of Christ's work in our place. And then he begins the slow work of changing us and making us more like Christ. It's amazing. It's the answer that we are all longing for. We all want to be known and loved, but we don't want to stay the way that we are. You say, love is just accepting me as I am. Oh, no, please don't accept me. If my wife just accepted me and left me as I was, awful. No, it's terrible. No, thankfully, by God's grace, He has worked through her. He has shaped me and changed me. We don't want to stay as we are. We know deep down that something is wrong. We know that we need salvation. And all of that is there waiting for us in Jesus Christ. We are His children. If you are in Christ, then you are known and you are loved and you are being made new. Those are the blessings of the gospel. Those are the effects of being born of Him. Brothers and sisters, are you experiencing that love? Are you experiencing that confidence and that conformity? If not, what's the solution? Well, last thing, how does this all happen? I think it's verse 2. I think it's verse 2 and verse 1. Verse 2 says, why are we going to be like Him? Well, what's going to happen to make us like Him? Because we shall see Him as He is. In verse 1, the King James again, behold what manner of love. Look, understand, meditate. Here's the bold plan. All your struggles with the problems that you're facing right now are a result of your not beholding the fact that God has made you His child. When you are distraught because of some circumstance in your life, it's because you are beholding that circumstance and not this truth. If you are a Christian, the degree that you behold the graciousness of God's adoptive love is the degree that you'll be able to handle criticism, that you'll be able to handle worry, that you'll be able to handle all of the problems that you have to face in your life. This is my goal for you, is to walk out of here not saying, all right, I better clean up my act, and I better try harder, and I better do a better job. No. But that if I behold that I am a child of God, then my problems will start to fade. Not that the problems go away, but that I will be able to better deal with those problems because I see my true and fixed and eternal identity in the eyes of the only one that matters. Ask yourself, how can you apply this to your life? And how could this truth that you are God's child and that God knows you and that He loves you and that He's making you like Him and that Christ is coming back for you, how can that truth affect that problem or that suffering that you are facing right now? Guys, this is what you need. You need to behold. You need to dwell on this. Behold what manner of love. Look, see, study, remember, meditate on this love. If you have been born of Him, you can have confidence in Christ's return. You can be like Him, and you are God's child. Those are the truths that you need to dwell on. Those are the truths that my prayer is that they would inform how you live your life, and they would inform how you see and deal with the problems of your life. Behold what manner of love. Guys, we don't understand how great it is that we can be called children of God. Bow with me and let me close with a word of prayer. Father, we thank You for Your word. We thank You for this reminder from John of the wonderful benefits of abiding in Christ and being born of Him. Father, we confess that we often fail to experience some of these great effects. Sometimes we don't have the confidence that we should. Sometimes we are a lot less like Christ than we would like to be. But we know that no matter what, if we are in Christ, that we are Your child. Nothing can change that. And that You love us, and that love is unchanging because it is settled and it's fixed because of the work of Jesus Christ in our place. So Father, I just simply ask that those of us who know You here in this room this morning, I pray that You would give them a great sense and a great hope and a great comfort from the fact that they are Your children, and that You have a special and abiding and eternal love for Your children, that You love them, that You know them, that You are seeking their good, and that You will return for them and restore them and make them new. I pray that they will find and take great comfort in that hope. Father, I pray for anyone else in here who does not know You and who understands that none of these things are true of them. Father, we ask for You to do Your work of grace in their hearts. Father, I pray that You would make them Your children. I pray that You would bring them from death to life. I pray that they would be born again so that they could respond in faith and repentance and come to You, Lord. We pray that this truth would be so desirable and attractive to us that it would shape and inform everything else that we do. Father, help us to behold. Help us to be amazed by the fact that we can be Your children though we deserve none of it. And that's because of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to love Him and appreciate Him more fully. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.